I'm supposed to speak about Shivaji Maharaj. Maybe I'm asked to speak about it because there is a book published in Maharashtra by Comrade Pansare, and that has been a very popular and demanded book in Maharashtra. So when we speak about the historical personalities, there is a need many times to evaluate the historicity and the relevance in today's time. So, fact and legend, myth and reality, these are the words associated with history and historical personalities. So, all great heroes of ancient and medieval past are found standing at the crossroads of fact and legend in the collective consciousness and imagination of the people. The image of a historical hero in the collective historical consciousness is evolved through many works and recordings of writers, poets, philosophers in the course of history. So fact and fiction become inseparable in the love for our heroes and in the hatred of our villains. So, however, often the interpretation of history becomes subjective and irrational. So, the years from 1980s to the present coincide with the unprecedented rise in communalism in India. So, many times the name of the great warrior Shivaji is used in this communal atmosphere. And so, it becomes essential to put forward a rational understanding of both the facts and the myths around Shivaji's persona and regime from a contemporary, secular and progressive standpoint. It becomes a need to challenge the mythology woven around Shivaji by Hindu nationalism. Shivaji, the founder of medieval Maratha kingdom in the 17th century, and numerous references to this remarkable man in the 17th century by Mughal, Portuguese and English sources suggest that he has seen as an astounding leader in southwestern India during his lifetime. So Shivaji was made an icon of pan-Indian Hindu nationalism by the nationalist historiography and movement, which developed in reaction to colonialism. The invention of Shivaji as a Hindu warrior ruler who had developed a deep-seated hatred for the Muslims can be credited to the Orientalist colonial imagination of grandeur. After this postulate that Shivaji hated the Muslims was laid down, most of Maratha historiography and Marathi historical fiction developed in the 19th and 20th century portrays this narrative. But there also exists a context of image of Shivaji crafted by Jyotiba Phule and his followers active in the Dalit Bahujan movements in the 20th century. So from a rationalist perspective, Shivaji emerges as an organic ruler of the common people of Maharashtra, broadly called the peasantry or the Shudras. The history of Shivaji has been an important issue of Maratha history. He has remained a very popular leader, a warrior fighter in Maharashtra. So it's important to see the way Shivaji dealt with the class and caste contradictions in the 17th century Maharashtra. The state set up by Shivaji created numerous opportunities for the upward social mobility of the lower caste, denied them by the traditional caste system in India. So Shivaji belonged to an elite military family, but his power rested on various sections of the peasantry. He gained their affections by curbing the power of the feudal ruling class of Maharashtra. He took several steps to enhance the sovereignty of his state in the overall interest of the oppressed in Maharashtra. So Shivaji was politically wise and became a king dedicated to the welfare of the subaltern subjects. So who was Shivaji? Hindutva icon or secular nationalist? Feudal ruler or peasant's king? Protector of cows and Brahmins or Shudra ruler? medieval looter, raider or builder of an empire. So if we look at various aspects of Shivaji's life, we come to know the difference in Shivaji and the other rulers, his contemporary rulers. So we see his administration with human approach. The crop estimate was made by just looking at the standing crop. It was agreed that the cultivating farmer kept for himself the third portion of his total produce while he paid two portions to the government. This was to be paid to the government in either kind or cash. This was to be paid to the government in many times in cash or crop. In critical times such as droughts, the government gave liberal loans to farmers. They were supposed to repay this amount in installments over a period of 4 to 5 years. So if any land were to be newly brought under cultivation and it were to be given to a new cultivator who did not own any cattle to work with, the government supplied everything to him. The cattle, seeds and even grains and money for this sustenance until he harvested the crops. So this had to be paid back after about 4 years. By giving such rights to till the land, almost all the arable land was brought under cultivation. The officers strictly warned to collect tax from rayots proportionate to their income, and no force should be exerted to them to pay taxes. So in drought situations, the tax collection was banned. He made a rule for cavalry of his army. No one should destroy the crops. This thing never happened before in any empire. If army needs any wood, it was a rule that the army should buy goods from farmers. He ordered the army that no one should take meal from rent. They should buy it from their salary. So he cared for every single farmer in his rent. This is especially important in the time when farmers are making suicides in lakhs, and it has become the, it shows the relevance of Shivaji. Then second point is respect for women. Women, especially the poor women, were sexually oppressed and exploited in feudal times. In such times, Shivaji's attitude in his respect was radically different. The story of Patil of village of Ranja is well chronicled. The officer Patil of village picked up in broad daylight a poor peasant's young daughter and raped her. Instead of living the rest of life in humiliation, she chose to die. She committed suicide. The whole village cried out. Shivaji heard this news. The Patil was arrested, brought to Pune, and severe punishment of cutting off his arms and legs was meted out. So the sentence was not only pronounced, it was implemented without delay. So the whole marvel of the province could not believe its eyes or ears. The riots fell for Shivaji, who did not hesitate to punish even the Patil, a feudatory, for raping a poor peasant's daughter. It was no surprise they got ready to sacrifice their own life for his cause. The cause was their own cause, protecting women from such atrocities. Shivaji warned his generals and soldiers that no women, whether Hindu or Muslim, should be harmed in battle. Shivaji issued a strict order that no one would take concubines or prostitutes or women servants with them when on campaigns. So, his administration is also related with language and approach towards language. So, Persian was language of communication between Subedas. So, Shivaji made Marathi compulsory in administration so that common people know what was going on. Then there are a number of myths related with the history of Shivaji as a person and his regime. So the new approaches to history tries to reject these myths woven around the name of Shivaji. The first and very common myth is Shivaji was an incarnation of God. So was Shivaji an incarnation of God? A large number of people believe this to be true. Some call him Shiva's incarnation. Others an incarnation of Vishnu. Shivaji was a human being. He was a good and great man. Shivaji had intelligence and foresight. He was a pragmatic man of morals. He was a brave and great warrior, but he was human. He was not a god. He was not an avatar. So, what are the consequences of turning a Shivaji into a god? If he is made to be a god, then we get away from our responsibility to emulate him. Then second point, that is, Shivaji succeeded because he wielded the Bhavani sword. Because we hear many times, Jai Bhavani, Jai Shivaji. That is the slogan prompted by many. So did Shivaji succeed because he wielded the Bhavani talwar, a sword blessed by goddess Bhavani? Researchers have shown that the Bhavani talwar was made in Portugal, where the techniques to forge swords from various metals was very advanced. The Portuguese brought this sword to Goa, from where it went to Savans, and then it came to Shivaji. Mother Bhavani did not play a role in the forging of this sword. That is to be made clear. So in Satara, there is a sword in a museum that some say that it was used by Shivaji. There is an ongoing dispute as to whether this is the Bhavani Talwar. On that sword, there is an inscription in Portuguese. So anyone can see that. The third and very important today myth that we are fighting with is the myth Shivaji an anti-Muslim Hindu Raja. So the new outlook questions this Hindu communal appropriation of Shivaji as an anti-Muslim Hindu Raja. Being a Hindu Raja in the 17th century did not necessarily mean being a Hindu communal ruler dedicated to the destruction of Islam. How else is the employment of Muslim in large numbers by Shivaji in his navy and other services to be explained? We can recount the role which numerous Muslim commanders played in Shivaji's armed forces. There were at least 13 major Muslim commanders or soldiers in Shivaji's army. I can name them Siddi Hilal, Daulat Khan, Ibrahim Khan, Qazi Haider, Siddi Ibrahim, Siddi Wawa, Noor Khan Beg, Shama Khan, Hussein Khan Miryani, Siddi Mistri, Sultan Khan, Daud Khan and Madari Mehtar. So if Shivaji was committed to the extermination of Islam in India, why did he get Afzal Khan buried with full military honours after slaying him in 1659 and sanctioned funds for the upkeep of his tomb? So Shivaji treated Muslims and Islam with respect and was not averse to establishing relations with those Hindus who had converted to Islam and wished to reconvert to Hinduism. Religion was important to pre-colonial Indians like it was to all pre-modern societies in general. But unlike 16th century Europe, the wars of religion were not to be found in India. That is history. If communalism was absent in medieval India, how could the majority of Indian rulers have been communal? Shivaji's vision was Swaraja, that is freedom, not Hinduism. The fourth myth, that is, he was Go Brahman Pratipalak. He was the protector of cows and Brahmins. So this has become very important in the time when Go Rakshaks have been committed to save cows in the name of Hinduism. So Brahmins performed a Kot Chandi Yajna to oppose Shivaji. That was done to support Mirza Raja Jai Singh, the mighty nobleman serving the emperor of Delhi, who came to Maharashtra to defeat Shivaji. Brahmins in Maharashtra opposed Shivaji's anointment as Chhatrapati, saying he was not entitled to be a king according to Hindu law. So Gaga Bhatta was brought from Banaras and he performed the rituals to anoint Shivaji. So how can you say now that he was the protector of Brahmins, only Brahmins? So significance of Shivaji's secular approach today, that is the most important part of this speech. So today Hindu-Muslim riots are taking place in Shivaji's name. We must tell these religious fanatics that Shivaji himself was not a fanatic. He had faith in Hindu religion, that's true, but he did not hate Islam. He believed in God, but he was not superstitious. Just as Hindus have riots among them, there are rioters among Muslims as well. They too have their own religious fanatics. So we should question these Muslim fanatics also. What about those who spill their blood, who sacrifice their life for Swaraj? Were they not their forefathers? Who does choose to stand with Aurangzeb and Adil Shah or Madari Mehtar, Ibrahim Khan, Daulat Khan or Qazi Haider? That is the question which can be put before these Muslim fanatics also. So Shivaji's Swaraj was not for Hindus alone. It was equally for the Muslims in Maharashtra, that we should remember. So now the last part is, why there is distortion of history? Why there is distortion of these personalities, historical personalities? And what purpose we see behind this? So those who are well off in terms of power, wealth, status and knowledge do not use force alone to maintain their hegemony. They do not use only weapons, treacherous and the state. They use ideas. They use history. They encourage such ideas amongst the people. So they make them digest the philosophy and the history which is useful to maintain their own superiority. Such thought and philosophy, such false, half-true and distorted history help to maintain the status quo. Thought is a very effective weapon. It lasts a very long time. So it is superior to the gun. The rulers always use this weapon against the oppressed. So those who have something to lose, power and wealth, use all weapons of the privileged to safeguard their authority. So those who have nothing to lose, who are dispossessed, need to sharpen the weapon of their ideology. Change is not possible without ideas, without thoughts. This is the reason why the riots today must fathom Shivaji's history. It should be interpreted in a meaningful way. And if we interpret history, we interpret Shivaji in a rational, progressive way, then only we can fight the misuse of these historical personalities. We can stop misuse of history and bring into reality the real secular society that is meant for the constitution of India. Thank you.